And here we are coming to you live from the Top Secret Broadcasting Bunker here at Area 52. Pastor Mike here, and I am online, and I am live. And this is the talk show Hell Hates. The more you listen today, I guarantee you, the more you'll know why liberals hate us, Bible haters hate us, hell hates us. And I'm speaking of all of us who love the Word of God, who believe the Word of God, who decided that they're not going to change the Word of God. We're going to leave it the way it is. We're not smart as God. We're not smarter than God. We're not smarter than the Bible. We are definitely not smarter than the Holy Spirit. So when we read our Bible, we just accept that what it says, it's true. And why not? Jesus told us that it was true. God tells us that everything in this world is a liar. I'm a liar, you're a liar, he's a liar, she's a liar. Wouldn't you like to be a liar too? We all are. Let God be true and every man a liar. So why can't we just read our Bible and believe what it says? But instead, everybody wants to accuse us of, oh, you're worshiping an idol, you worship a Bible. You're absolutely right. Guilty as charged. The beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and his name is the Word of God. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. So I say I don't have a choice. I have a choice. And at one time, I didn't believe that everything in my Bible was true. I thought, well, you know, I heard that there was mistakes in the translation, and there was mistakes in the transmission of text, and they have proof, and Westcott and Hort had better. Then God kind of, I won't say he knocked me around a little bit. He had done that already. He had chastened me. And then he got me just reading and studying the Word of God, and then God began to lead me down a path and said, Mike, this Bible's true. Do you believe it? I do. I do, God. I believe every word of God is true. Thy word is truth. All thy words are pure words. As silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times, thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. And if you believe that, hell will hate you. Liberals will hate you. Cultists will hate you. Hebrew roots followers will hate you, and they don't mind telling you. They don't mind showing their arrogance and their pride at how the exalted information that they have, because they pretend to speak Hebrew, but they don't. They pretend that God is invoked somehow by the sprechen of the Hebrew. But he's not. You don't just pull God down from heaven because you said these little magic words. That was sort of the premise of the Enchanter series. Part four came out this week. If you have not seen it, if you have not seen all four parts, but especially part number four, I encourage you to do so, not because it's me on there. And there's less of me than there was a month ago. Okay? Significantly less of me than there was a month ago. Praise God for that. But if you haven't seen it, I encourage you to watch it because it's going to open your eyes. Ryan, a man in our church, and I were talking about it this morning. He said he watched it. He said, I never thought about it, but he said, you're right. This praise and worship thing where everybody's telling everybody, oh, you've got to worship God. The problems that you're having in life, you're not worshiping God enough. If you would get into worship and worshiping God and doing all these things, then God would release things to you. And I remember hearing that teaching at our denominational youth camp probably 15 years ago. And I kept hearing this recurrence of these teachers and these pseudo-preachers telling everybody about how important worship is. And if you don't worship God, then you're outside of God's will. And you must worship God if you want to get from God. And the reason why you're out in sin is you're not worshiping God enough. And it didn't sound right to me then. Didn't click. Just something wasn't right about it. And I said, why are all of a sudden now they're just pushing this thing of worship? We have to worship. We have to worship. And that same year, I had a pastor, a man that I had known for years, chew me out because the the services at the youth camp had gone from a traditional camp style singing, you know, songs and having a good time. And they had gone to this praise and worship stuff where the worship leader was getting, okay, everybody stand up. Now everybody clap your hands. Now everybody wave like this. Now we're going to sing Let It Rain 45 times in a row. And while everybody's standing, my wife and I and some other people from our church were just sitting there going, we were trying to sing the songs. We didn't know half of them. And he chewed me out. And he said, you should have stood with everybody else. You're a pastor. You should give the example. You should be the example to these people. And he was really ticked that I sat down during the worship service. And I was thinking to myself, who am I doing this for? If I just go along with everybody else simply because it looks good, then that's the flesh, not the spirit. That's not the way we're supposed to worship God. And so that was part of us just backing out and saying, if this is how it's going to be, we don't want any part of it, and we still don't. So if you have not seen it, I encourage you to watch it. That serpent that Aaron's rod became, you'll see what it is in the Bible, and you'll see what it means when it's swallowed up. I like that phrase. Because God caused a great fish to swallow up Jonah. Death is swallowed up in victory. Aaron's rod swallowed up the magician's rods that turned to serpents. And how did they get them to turn to serpents? How did the magicians of Pharaoh take a dead wooden rod and make them come alive into serpents through their enchantments, their incantations, their power words, their mystical words, their tetragrammaton, their sacred name? That's how they did it. They were probably singing Let It Rain 45 times in a row until that rod became a serpent. So I just encourage you to watch it. Somebody sent me an email earlier today, and I appreciate all the emails. I have not had a chance to read all of them, nor have I had a chance to respond to most of them. But this lady sent, and she said, Pastor, when you were talking about the Jason Bourne series of movies, the fourth one, where the lead character, who is a CIA agent, and he's been mentally enhanced, and he has been physically enhanced. He has had his DNA altered. And in the opening scene, I don't know if you've not seen this, in the opening scene, he's rising up out of the water. And I'm just going, hey, I know what that is. I know what that is. He's rising up. By the way, the Percy Jackson movie? Opening scene, Percy Jackson, who is a son of the gods and the son of a human woman, is sitting on the bottom of the pool, and he's just sitting there. And all of a sudden, you see him rise up, okay? And I'm just going, I know what that is. But anyway, he's up in the Alaskan wilderness, and he's doing some of this test trial or whatever it is of his enhancements. He jumps from mountain to mountain, and he tells another agent that he's being chased by this pack of wolves, that they're trying to get to him. And he said, that's not normal. Wolves don't chase humans. If they encounter one, they'll stand their ground, they'll pull their hunches up, and they'll show their teeth, but they won't chase a human. Something was different about him. And lady was watching that, and she does this, okay? She thinks Bible, which is what you should do with everything. You should think Bible. And she said, this verse came to mind. It's in Exodus chapter 11. If you got a great big old King James Bible, or if you have the Pure Bible Search software, or if you just happen to have that verse memorized. Exodus chapter 11, this is the Israelites coming out of Egypt. And let me just say this. This is a wonderful, wonderful verse on spiritual warfare and how God will protect us from spirits, from devils, which are beasts. They're animals. That was one of the messages I was trying to convey in the enchanter part, was the whole idea of enchantments. It's like giving commands to dogs and to animals. They understand it on a very primary way. And you say, you know, Fido, sit. Fido, stand. Fido, you know, go get my slippers or whatever. He may understand his name. He may understand slippers and know the actions. But beyond that, they can't think that way. God gives us protection and the ability to stand against him. And in Exodus chapter 11, you look at it in verse 6, and there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as there was none like it, nor shall be like it any more. But against, listen to this one, but against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue, against man or beast, that you may know how that the Lord doth put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. Let me hear some people shout and cheer unto the Lord. Let me tell you what this is. Dogs are, number one, dogs don't go to heaven. I am not even going to get into that one. Dogs do not go to heaven. Dogs are outside of the gates. They're not allowed in. Dogs are represented, who was it? Anubis. One of the Egyptian gods was a dog-headed, half-human, half-dog god. And dogs are representative of certain spirits in the Bible, just like wolves are, just like foxes are, birds are, serpents, pigs, unclean animals, they're all eagles, they're all representatives of spirits that are around us. Some of them are good, some of them are not good. But he said God was going to do something, and he was going to put a difference. He said that the world and you may know that there's a difference between you and the Egyptians. Egypt is always a type or a foreshadowing of, let's say, the kingdom of this world, the kingdom of Satan, the worldliness that is in this world, mystery Babylon, the deeds of people and their lascivious lies and all their false gods. That's what Egypt is. Doesn't surprise me then that the Sinaiticus and Alexandrinus manuscripts that the new translations are based upon came from planet Egypt. That's where they came from. And God says, I want you to know that I put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. Now, maybe that's what, I don't know who to call them, the powers that be on this earth right now, maybe that's what they're looking for as far as wanting a sample of everybody's DNA. Because if you think about it, genetically there is a difference between Israel and the Egyptians. The Egyptians descended from Ham. The Israelites descended, of course, from Abraham and then Peleg. Let's see here. Was it Ham, Shem? Shem, which means name. Shem, the words Semite or anti-Semite comes from Shem. Israelites are the descendants of Shem. Egyptians are descendants of Ham. There is a genetic difference between the Egyptians and the Israelites. But I think it goes beyond that. And when it comes to how you and I are supposed to live and how we are supposed to conduct our lives and how we are supposed to be in this present evil world, being in the world is one thing. Being of the world is a completely different issue. We are not to be of this world and let the influences of this world control us. And it's hard to do. It is extremely difficult not to be affected or let our minds be affected by the content and the things that are in this world. And there's always somebody online on social media or whatever that is eager to jump you when they detect something that they see as worldliness out of you. I don't think that way. You do too, you little liar. You just don't admit it. Because I don't know anybody in this world that is a born-again Christian that does not in some way struggle with the things of this world. And it is a struggle. But there is a difference between us and them. Even, even at times when we succumb to the temptations of this world, we are different than they are in that we will go back to our Father and say, Father, drive this out of me however you can. Take a rod, use whatever to lead me out of it, but get me out of this world. I hate it. That's the difference between you and them. And God said he would not let a dog move his tongue like this. Something like that. I don't know. But you understand the idea. A dog would not approach him. Dogs won't come against him. Dogs cannot have any power over them because God won't let it, because there is a difference between you and Egypt. And God made that to be so, and I rejoice at that. I appreciate whoever sent me that. That was a blessing to me, and I like it. And had I known that verse, I certainly would have used it in the illustration. Now, I've got something. I'm going to talk about Justice Scalia here before too long. And I just did a lot of thinking about it yesterday. And even over the weekend, I was thinking about it last night. I'll talk a little bit more about it. I don't want to get into it now. I've got something else that's right on the top of my mind. But my biggest question is, why was there not an autopsy? Why was there not an autopsy? And I'll explain what I mean here in just a little bit. If you know anything about that, and there are conspiracy theories everywhere, some of them are justified. Now I'm waiting for the false flag people to come out and say there was really no such thing as Justice Scalia. He never existed. That was a stage actor, a crisis actor. We saw him in a movie. We saw him in a Broadway play. That was all the setup scene. It's going to bring in the New World Order. They're going to bring in gun control, and that never really happened. I'm waiting for these people to show up. So far they haven't showed up yet that I have seen. The people who say that everything that's going on in the world is fake. The people who say that every mass shooting in America never actually happened. Didn't happen. And according to them, there has been not a single multiple homicide take place in the United States of America ever. Or since the advent of television. Because that's what they believe. They believe that all these mass shootings were hoaxes. They were frauds. They were put on. No one actually died. And every one of them was supposed to bring in gun control. So far, none of them have. I'm not saying the government's squeaky clean on everything. And I'll explain that here in a little bit. I ran across a video. Let me turn my Bible over here. I ran across a video that I had in the queue all weekend. It's on YouTube. Now, I can't remember if somebody sent me this video or if it was somebody sent me a video to watch, and I did, and then that was on the like on the side of YouTube, and I clicked it, and it looked interesting, and I clicked it, and it brought it up, and I hit pause, and I hadn't watched it. So I come in this morning, and I sit down here at the microphone and in front of the screen here, and I see that there, and I'm going, you know what? I got a little time. I'm going to look into that. And I start, and what I was presented with in this video is something that to me is brand new. We know that prophecy will be fulfilled. God already sees it. God actually sets prophecy in motion. He knows it's going to happen, and you could say he's the reason why it happened. God made a devil. God made an angel, called him Lucifer. Even the devil worshipers know that's Lucifer. Even the New Agers know who Lucifer is. It's the modern Bible critics that, that's not really his name. His name really is not Lucifer. That's a poor translation. Really, it's the morning star that fell from heaven. And I'm just going, there's no way in the world the morning star fell from heaven. Because I know who the morning star is, the day star. It's Jesus Christ. But anyway, God made Satan. He made the dragon, the devil, the serpent. And he made him so magnificently. You look marvelous. He looked so wonderful that he got to adoring himself. My, don't I look snappy today? And then pride began to build up, and he began to covet. Began to covet. He was the anointed cherub that covereth. I get this idea. I don't know how true it is, but I know from the book of Exodus, I know through the book of Psalms, God mentioned himself as the one who dwells between the cherubims. That when Moses designed the Ark of the Covenant, he was to put two cherubs with their wings covering the ark. There was two cherubs that, and I mean right now, that covered the throne of God for whatever reason. And God called the serpent, Lucifer, the anointed cherub that covereth. Maybe he was the one over that throne or whatever. But he's looking at that throne and he covets that throne. He wants to sit where God sits. He's in the garden of God. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering. 10 stones that cover him. Musical instruments are part of his body. The next Watchmen series, I have part of the script written. Next Watchmen series, starting next Sunday, is dealing with familiar spirits. And I didn't really plan so much on it going this direction, but yesterday as I started begin to laying it out, that's the direction it took. And I'm just, by the time I was done yesterday, I was just kind of like, there's devils all around us here. To say that there are devils in modern music is a huge understatement. The devil knows music and he knows how to use it to manipulate the minds of men, and he's doing it. But he's made of music, and he's in the garden of God, and he goes to Eve and he says, and this is really the temptation there, ye shall be as gods. And so I'm always on the lookout for technology articles, science articles, any kind of esoteric ideologies that is trying to bring man to godhood. And this video was that. Now, I put this video on the Pastor Mike Online Facebook page. It is facebook.com/, you can see it right there. Pastor Mike, facebook.com/PastorMikeOnline. And there's about, five, six, seven, eight articles. A lot of them dealt with Scalia. But that video is posted. And it's about engineering the brain, engineering humans to be superhumans. Engineering them, which means we're going to build it with our own hands. We're going to take the human brain and we're going to alter it and enhance it. Now, I started watching this video. I am not done with it because I had to stop at a certain point and say, number one, I'm going to meditate on this. I'm going to think on this, and I'm going to think how it relates to the Bible. And then I don't have time to do it today, but I've got it in my watch list on YouTube, along with a couple of others, and I'm going to watch these things. I'm going to spend some time studying them. The idea is that, and there's a man by the name of Silva who has a program, I think, on the Discovery Channel called Brain Games. And I kind of like that show because I'm very interested in the operations of the mind, the brain, because I think, and I'm pretty sure, that's where the new paradigm is going to take place. It's going to take place in the brain or the heart of man. And there is going to be a paradigm shift. There's going to be a change in the way that humans think. No doubt in my mind about it. God is going to turn people over to a reprobate what? A reprobate mind. That's Romans chapter 1. To do things that are not convenient. He's going to send forth a great lie, and people are going to believe it. A strong delusion. And people are going to fall for it. Fall, they will. And the reason why is, and it's just like, does God lie? No. But he's sure got a big truckload of devils who will do it for him. And he dispatches them just like he did in the days of Ahab. God was setting Ahab up for his own death by sending a lying spirit to the prophets, 400 men that prophesied to Ahab saying, oh, you're going to see these iron horns? You're going to use these to push the enemies back and God's going to give you the victory. It sounds like a Joel Osteen sermon. It sounds like something you would get out of a lot of churches nowadays about how good you are and how much victory you're going to get all the time. And Ahab fell for it. But a lying spirit, a strong delusion is going to be put forth in this world. Something's going to change and alter the minds of men. Just like Nebuchadnezzar, for seven times passed over him, a beast's heart was given to him. He did not think rationally. He did not think as a human. He ate grass. His hair grew out wild. His fingernails became claws. Probably scratched his ear with his right foot. That was a pretty good one, wasn't it? We don't even want to get into how he bathed himself, but that's who he was. The Bible says seven times passed over him. And this video is about a concept, and I never really thought about this until I watched the video, but it's true. They describe what they call a flow. Now, for some of you, that is why you have to get up like four or five times every night, okay? But they called it the flow, and here's how they define it. I'm looking at my notes here. The project that they're talking about is called the Flow Genome Project. Let me, instead of me asking you to go look up their website, I'm going to show you their website. You're just, get ready. We're going to, let me do this here. We're going to cue the music here. Get ready, okay? The Flow Genome Project. Here we go. See that logo right there? The Triquetra, you know what that is? That's the Tower of Babel. That is lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. That is, here's the two-strand DNA. Here's a third one added to it. See this all-seeing eye here? That's multiple things. It's the all-seeing eye. It's the capstone. It is the nexus. When you take two circles and join them together, you have what's in the middle, a mandorla, a female symbol, and it represents the nexus between two universes or two worlds, third in the human world and the spiritual world. They shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. That's what that symbol is. This video here, let me show you. Let's see here. Get past some of the talking. Oh, watch the logo form here. Oh, that's at the beginning. Let me get to the end. And you're going to watch the logo form at the end, and you're going to see right there. See, this is what they put, what was that band? It wasn't Bruno Mars, it was that other band, I can't remember who it was, at the Super Bowl, the Flower of Life. And you have six-petaled flower here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here we go with the music again, dun, dun, dun. This is so new agey, but the science is what they're dealing with. And let me explain to you the flow genome. Let me pull my notes up again. The guy describes it as the what's called the optimum of consciousness. You've seen this happen. Maybe you've experienced it. Basketball players who are in the zone, Michael Jordan, game 6 of the NBA playoffs, not only does he have the flu, He scores 45 points in one game. The things he was doing with a basketball in that game, I watched it live. I remember it. I'm just going, there's no way in the world people can do that. At one time in the game, he gets a breakaway. He's bouncing the ball down the middle of the court toward his goal. He goes up to the basket like this in midair. You think he's just going to lay it in. At the last millisecond, he takes the ball then in his left hand and comes around and slams dunk it. And I'm just going, how do you do that? He was in the flow. Comedians who, I mean, they have their pre-written jokes they get on the stage, but every now and then, doesn't happen all the time, but every now and then, their mind becomes super sharp, and they start ad-libbing and telling jokes and one-liners, and you've got people in stitches, and they just do this on and on and on and on, and it's just amazing. Jazz musicians who just start, and jazz is a musical form that I cannot understand. I mean, I like all my chords to be chords, all right? I knew a guy that could play just an incredible jazz piano. I'm going, how do you do that? Jerry Garcia of the Grateful Dead. When the Grateful Dead would do concerts, unlike being in a recording studio where, you know, time is limited and a song has to be 3, 4, 5 minutes or whatever, not any more than that, Jerry Garcia would be out there and they would sing maybe two verses of the song, and then it would cut into a musical bridge where Garcia is going to take his guitar and he's going to play a few licks. Garcia was known for being in the flow and standing there in one song. One song would end up being, it would be 30 minutes of nothing but riffs on the guitar. Literally that long. He would just keep playing and coming up with more riffs and more riffs and more riffs and things like that. Now, next, and I'm glad I saw this now. Next Sunday, I'm going to talk about rock and roll stars and familiar spirits. Because we know, they admit that when they get on stage, something happens. Something takes over. I have heard rock and roll artists, The Who, I can't remember who the singer for The Who was, but he said, when I get out on stage, there's just something of a very primitive nature that takes over me. And he said, while I'm on stage and I'm performing and that thing is there, I probably would, if somebody came at me, I'd probably kill him. Beyoncé. Or Bouncy. Bouncy, and she's got this interview on YouTube. I have one of our watchers sent me the transcript. Thank you for that transcript, because I'm going to use that. You sent it at the right time. She admitted that the things that she does in performance cannot be her, because she's not that way. She's not that good. She's not that gifted. Something comes over, and she actually gave it a name called Sasha Fierce. Is this double identity that she has. When she was performing in the Super Bowl halftime show, that was not Bouncy. That was Sasha Fierce. I know what that is. It is a familiar spirit. It is a devil that takes control of her. It enables her to sing some of the notes and some of the things that you just go, how do you do that with your voice? How do you do that? How do you have such a clear, crisp voice, be able to do that night after night after night in concerts? How do you do that? Sasha Fierce takes over. Even Bob Dylan, who at one time claimed that he had converted to Christianity, Keith Green bought it. Keith Green actually used, who was I just talking about? Bob Dylan playing the harmonica in a cut of one of his songs, I Pledge My Head to Heaven. Because he thought Bob Dylan was saved. Bob Dylan is not saved. Bob Dylan admitted to Ed Bradley of 60 Minutes that he made a pact with the devil, and that's how he said, I'm keeping up my part of the bargain. That's how I'm able to do these things that I'm doing right now. So I want you to understand. Now, I'm not saying that every time you have something at work where you are just really putting it out that day. I have those days. I have times when I'm preaching where, I mean, my mind is very, very sharp and very focused on what it is that I'm preaching. Verses are just flying out of me because they're coming into me. I think that's the help of the Holy Spirit. There's no doubt in my mind about it because I can't do it without him. And I like the fact that even when my mind is all over the place and it's not very sharp that day, I preach. God helps me. God makes me say something simple that just is a blessing to people, or it's a blessing to me. But they're talking about this. An ER doctor, let's say in Chicago, Detroit, or New York, one of these bad, bad inner city, downtown emergency room doctors who are making all these split-second decisions one after another on multiple patients. He's in the flow now. And so I believe it. I think that it happens to everybody at some point in their life related to something that they do, something, some kind of work that they do or whatever. You probably experienced, you've had days when you've been very productive. You've had days where you're just dragging your feet, not getting anything done. Those days happen. But here's what they're describing now. They're describing this event that takes place. And this guy did the statistics, and he said that business people, executives, who, if they get in the flow on Monday, they could take Tuesday through Friday off because they got more done that day than they would have all the whole rest of the week. Five times more productive than they normally would be. Now, here's the thing. It does happen to people. It happens to everybody. Sometimes even me, if I'm in a sort of a playful mood or whatever, just being with people or preaching or whatever, sometimes jokes just, well, they're coming. And I'm going, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. So it happens to everybody. But here's what they're trying to engineer this. They're trying to find out, they sort of know how it works. And I'm going to give you just a few bits of that this morning, because it is so new to me, and I just have some of the basics down. But they're trying to understand what triggers it, what makes it happen. And when they find out, they're going to develop a way to make it happen all the time. Now, that you may say, well, that sounds good. Not so fast. Because if you saw the movie, what was it? Scarlett Johansson. What movie was that? Where she swallowed, where the drug dealers, Chinese drug lords, put this new drug in her, and this guy was kicking her in the stomach and it ruptured open, and she's got this drug flowing into her body, and she's now, Lucy is what it is, Lucifer, Lucy. She's now starting to use 10%, 20%, 30%, 40% of her brain. When she gets to 100, she's a god. And these guys in this video described it as, you know, we say sometimes we want the ability to use more of our brain, more of our brain, more of our brain. And he said, with the flow, that's not true, and there's a reason why. And I want you to kind of focus on what I'm saying here, because I'm going to try to say it right. I'm going to try to say it slow, but this is, to me, this is important. We know that, you know, we have two halves of our brain, left and right. See how simple that is? The left side controls the cognitive thinking, you know, right and wrong, yes or no. This, everything, sees that everything is black and white. Here's the file. Here's the RAM, random access memory. Here's the file folders. Here's where all the information is. And if someone asks you directions to somewhere, you're going to pull the directions out of here. Over here is the creative side. This is where we hear music. This is where we sing songs, write music, paint pictures, things like that. This is the part that can lie really well. because what it does, it draws a picture of a new truth. It draws a picture of what you want to say to somebody rather than what the guys over here in the cubicles with the file folders and the computers are saying. No, the information is this, and you're drawing a picture of something totally opposite of that. That's where that comes from. But there's also the brain is segmented, and it does different functions. Now, I want you to kind of understand where I'm thinking with on this thing. And if you want to do some more research on the Flow Genome Project, be my guest. Send it to me. All right. And if you watch a video on it, like a 2-hour-long video on it, if you can transcribe the relevant parts and give me the times, I would certainly appreciate that, because I don't really have a lot of time to sit and watch these things all day long. But anyway, do your own study of this, and if you want to help me out, that'd be great. But here's the problem with the flow. The prefrontal cortex of your brain is right here. Let's see if I have. I do. I looked up the thing on Wikipedia, and let me see. Let me click this, and I'll show you. There you go, right here. Here is the prefrontal cortex of your brain. It's in the. Let me tell you where it is. It's in the forehead. Think about it. Now, let me tell you what this part of your brain does. This is what Wikipedia says. The most typical psychological term for functions carried out by the prefrontal cortex area is called executive function. The word execute doesn't mean kill somebody unless their sentence is a sentence of death, and then they must execute the sentence. In Windows or DOS-based programs, The program that you're going to use, like Microsoft Word, or I'm using Wirecast here, so Wirecast or Chrome, Chrome web browser, whatever, the main file that executes the instructions is called an EXE file. It's called an executive or an executable file. It is one that once you get it running, it starts executing all of these instructions to put stuff on your screen and do what it's supposed to do. So the executive function of the brain is just like the president. He's the executive branch. He's the executive leader. The executive part of the brain is what executes actions and reactions and makes very, very important critical decisions. The executive function, and I'm reading this, relates to abilities to differentiate among conflicting thoughts, determining good and bad, better and best, same and different. Now, I'm going to stop right here, because I want to take this, then I want to go to the Bible. In the study of wine and strong drink, you remember when we did that? When God commanded the Levite priests not to drink wine and strong drink, he said, "Do not drink wine or strong drink, thou nor thy sons with thee." Why? Because he said, if you partake of strong drink, you will no longer be able to tell the difference between holy and unholy, between clean and unclean. That is the executive decision-making function of the prefrontal cortex, your forehead. It's your forehead that determines right, wrong, true, false, holy, unholy. And then it says, this part of your brain determines the future consequences of current activities. It is the reason why I will no longer play with live electrical wires. Because I look at it and I say, I know what will happen to me if I touch that. It's the reason why in wintertime, when I walk around my house, when I walk around this church with all this carpeted floor, I am constantly, with the back of my hand, touching the outside corners of walls because I know how that's made. I used to hang drywall, and on every outside, not the inside corner, okay, the outside corner, on every one of those, there is a piece of metal, it's aluminum, it's called corner bead or tin or something like that, but it's called corner bead. And it is what makes the corner on a wall. And the tapers or the drywall finishers go in with their joint compound and they kind of bridge the gap. It's kind of beveled out. It bridges the gap between the edge of the corner and the smooth part of the drywall because there's a big chasm there. And they fill that with mud about three or four times to where you can't tell the difference. It looks like all one smooth wall. And I know that's there. And I go around touching that with the back of my hand all winter long. Why? Because I do not like electrons building up inside of my body, giving me the potential electric charge. I don't like it. Every time I slide my chair out or take my big, heavy, hooded sweatshirt off, I am loaded with electrons. I am charged. And if I make the mistake of not thinking about it and discharging myself deliberately in a way that will not hurt, when I touch something and it shocks, I don't like it. Understandably so. It is my forehead that makes that decision. It is my forehead that tells me if someone says, hey, want to go hang gliding today? My forehead says, no. Hey, want to go jump out of an airplane? No. Hey, I just learned how to skateboard. You want to go skateboarding with me at a skate park where they're going to jump stuff and fly in the air? And no, I don't want to do that. Why? Because my forehead says, can't do that. We have this joke amongst us not so sophisticated Americans. Something that guys or gals will do at parties where there's a little bit of strong drink going around. A guy will say, here, hold my cup. Watch what I do. And somebody, hopefully, has got a camera out filming it, going to put it on YouTube. Look up the word fail on YouTube, and you're going to find all these drunk people doing stupid stuff and getting hurt. Why? Because they're drunk. Because the forehead of their brain has been put out of commission, and they cannot, watch this, they cannot understand the future consequences of current activities. They can't do it. Why? Because they're drunk. The flow, then, that these guys, here's what they're telling you. They're telling you that when someone is in the flow, and again, this can happen to anybody, when someone is in the flow, what has happened for some reason is the prefrontal cortex, the forehead of the brain, has reduced its activity. Now you're getting more creative things to do. And there's other parts of the brain that are kicking in to help you do these things. Like I said, mentioned Jerry Garcia. He's standing there with a guitar and a pick, and this part of the executive part of his brain has diminished somehow, and he is playing riffs that he's probably never learned before. But his creativity is such that he is just really able to put it out. Sasha Fierce, Beyonce said that when Sasha Fierce takes over her, she said, I can fall, I can cut my leg on something, and I absolutely will not know it. And there's a reason why. Because these guys, in their study of the frontal cortex and the flow, they say that one of the things that the brain does when it's in this thing is that it releases dopamine. It's where we get the word dope from, I think, maybe. I don't know. Endorphins. You know what that is? The body has the ability to make a painkiller like morphine, similar to morphine, only 100 times more potent than morphine. Now, let me just say this. When I'm in deep pain, post-surgery or after my accident or whatever. I do not mind them giving me morphine in the hospital. Fact, kind of like it. There's a reason why. It kills the pain, and it gives you this euphoria. Now, you and I both know that there is a huge problem in this country with drug abuse. Why? Cocaine, methamphetamine, heroin, which is from opium, which is where Vicodin and Oxycontin and other derivatives of that come from. They're opiates. Cocaine, crack, methamphetamine, heroin, ecstasy. None of these drugs make you feel bad at first. Nobody ever does coke and says, "Oh, I feel terrible. Oh, I wish I'd never done that." No. It's the opposite. It does something. It releases something, or it's just part of something that makes them absolutely feel out of this world. They even describe in this video that there is a part of this process that's similar to what marijuana does in the brain. They said it makes you think laterally. Now, I'm going to look that up. I don't know what that is, but I'm going to look that up. Some of you may know. And the reason why high-up tech executives in Silicon Valley, California, and probably other places in this country and around the world, the reason why they are taking low doses of LSD and smoking marijuana is because it is enabling them to think in a way that they were never able to while they were sober. Probably the reason why we have all these tech companies making all of these new innovative ideas about building robots that can think and destroy us, or altering the human genome, because the forehead of their brain has been diminished while they were doing this research, and they're not able to analyze how bad this is going to turn out if we do this. It's like they don't care. So let me continue reading this article, because it's very, very important. This part of the brain, the forehead, future consequences of current activities, working toward a defined goal, prediction of outcomes. It's like the guys who are holding the cup of the guy who said, "Hold my cup and watch this." Everybody else who's not as drunk as that guy, they're watching this going, "This is not going to turn out good. Get your phone out and cover this. Record this. This is not going to turn out good. This is going to be on YouTube right now. This is fail in progress." The rest of everybody can see this is not a good idea. Back in the early days of the hippie movement, with LSD running all over the place, you had guys standing on top of buildings thinking they could fly. Their forehead had been diminished. Their thought process is here. Had been diminished in such a way is that they were not able to discern the outcome of what would happen if they stepped off that building. They believed that they could fly. The only problem was they just didn't have the ability to do it. But they didn't think that anything could go wrong here. Prediction of outcomes, expectation based on actions, social control, the ability to suppress urges that, if not suppressed, could lead to socially unacceptable outcomes. Why is it, and I'm only going to speak for America, because in other countries, this is not an issue, or this, they just do it this way. Why is it in America, as we're walking down the public streets, or we are in a department store or a grocery store or at the tractor supply store or whatever, why is it that we do not just go to the bathroom right out in front of everybody? Because God built into us the shame of nakedness. We do not do that. Now, I've heard in France and other places, they just go. Maybe not. I don't know. Maybe I heard something that wasn't true. But in America, we don't do that. And here's why. The Executive Action Committee of our brain realizes that, number one, that is socially unacceptable. Number two, it is gross. It's grotesque. And who's going to clean that up? Number three, it's telling us if we do this, we'll get arrested. There's probably some kids walking around, and you're going to get busted. Bad. So we don't do that. This part of the brain tells us, when you're drunk, you don't give a flip about where you stop and go to the bathroom. Think Mardi Gras. That's the forehead. This part of your brain is your morality processing center. It tells you that even though, now listen to me, even though you want to do something, you know that morally it is objectionable, it is wrong, the consequences are too great, and you're just not going to do it. You might have thought it, but you're not going to do it. I mean, why is it that nobody has affairs in the open? And I mean, like, out on the street in the open. Why is it no one does that? But we think it. It's because the Executive Action Committee here in the forehead of our brain tells us, number one, you will get arrested. Number two, you'll get divorced. Your wife or your husband's going to take your kids, going to take 90% of your stuff. God hates it. God said, don't do it. But we still have the urge to do it. Or any kind of immorality. Words that we want to say that we don't say anymore. Or we don't say out loud. We don't say in front of the children. Why? That's the part of our brain that told us not to do that. Very, very important function. These guys are wanting to engineer a way around that. Now, again, think of drunkenness. And somebody that's drunk does not have the morality that a sober person does. And even Proverbs says that. Thine eyes will behold strange women. Your mouth will utter perverse things. Things that you would not normally do or say in a crowd, around people, around children, you would do it. There was a man, I've talked about this before, there was a man up here, a businessman. He was in town. He was staying at the Adams Mark Hotel, one of these nice, posh hotels downtown St. Louis, a business hotel. He was staying there. He went out and got himself bombed. Came stumbling back, drunk, ended up getting into the wrong room. Probably their door wasn't locked all the way or whatever. He thought it was his room. He ends up getting undressed, crawling into bed. Next thing you know, there's a 13-year-old girl there in bed. What does he do? He rapes her. Why? This was gone. His life ruined. Went to court. I don't know how the court found him not guilty, but I think the parents sued, and I think they won the civil suit. But the thing is, that Bible's right when it tells us not to be drunk, people. There's a reason why God tells us these things. Now, here's the really scary part. You know how it is when you get drunk. It makes you feel good. You want more. You know, some of you know how it is when you smoke marijuana or when you take a drug of coke or heroin or LSD or whatever. What is it? You feel so good, or meth, you feel so good you want more. And these guys on this video are admitting that when you get into this flow, your body's releasing dopamine, and it's releasing all these little chemicals that are making you feel good and making your brain work in a way that's never had before. And when you're in this flow, all of a sudden you want more. And so what these guys are going to do is they're going to figure out a way, and they are going to figure out a way. If I wanted to invest money in a company, I would throw it at this one, because I'm telling you, I think the devil's going to make sure these guys figure it out. They're going to figure out a way to trigger the flow. And when they do, they'll be billionaires. because people are going to do this. They're going to get this triggering mechanism. And once they do, they're going to want it more. And they're going to want it more. And they're going to want it more. And I'm telling you, I don't see anybody. And I think this is part and parcel of Mark of the Beast. I think there's going to come a time. I do not see anybody being dragged against their will to get the mark. I think they're going to beg for it. Just like heroin, just like how I've described the praise and worship services. The praise and worship services, I think, does something physically to people. I think there is a spirit involved that brings these people this emotional high, and they want more. And it keeps them coming back for more and more and more and more. Here is one of the things they were saying in this video. We intend to liberate the mind. We want to liberate ourselves to be able to get into this flow. Now, let me read a couple of scriptures here for you, because you know what I did. At one point, I'm taking notes on this thing, and I write the question, what is this in the Bible? What is this process, the flow? The flow is about releasing endorphins. Flow is the most addictive state we have. Once people experience this more often, they will want more. And at one point, the guy said flow is the opposite of the steady state, which is normal consciousness, which is your prefrontal cortex, your forehead, is in the steady state. It's keeping the ship where it needs to be, and we're not going to turn to the left, and we're not going to turn to the right, and we're not going to go chasing after other gods, and we're just going to keep on going because we know the right way. That's the steady state, and this is like the opposite of that. Todd Bentley speaks repeatedly of being in the flow at his lie sessions. And he talks about, we're going to bring everybody into the flow where I can kick you in the chest and get those devils out of you. That's how they speak. These people who are these exalted, charismatic, spirit liberators, drunkards, are repeatedly talking about getting into the flow. We're going to learn how to get into the flow. I want you to take that language, and I want you to think of what that would mean in the Bible. And the idea that came to me was a river or a stream. Let me read a couple of verses. Two that I found so far. Psalm 147:18, he sendeth out his word and melteth them. He causes his wind to blow and the waters flow. His word, a flow, a river. Proverbs 18:4, watch this now. The words of a man's mouth are as deep waters, and the wellspring of wisdom is as a flowing brook. So right here, I have what I think are two verses that match this. The wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook. Now, in your Bible, and had a man come down from Canada to explain this to me, and I went, that's cool. Rivers, brooks, things that flow, Jordan River, out of the throne of God, a river clear as crystal, flowing out of the throne of God. And the guy tells me, he said, Pastor, think of it this way. He said, there's rivers in the Bible that are clear and crystal and unpolluted. And he said, there are dirty rivers in the Bible. Ezekiel 32, Pharaoh is as a whale of the seas, and he fouled the waters. And he said, I think this is the clear river, is the pure word of God that flows. And I'm going, I like that. I like it. I think he's right. I like being in a place, whether I'm preaching or I'm just thinking, I'm just working on something or meditating on the word, where just one scripture after another is just flowing out. And I like that. I think there is an opposite of that. Dirty waters are dirty Bibles, perversions of the word of God. The devil muddied the waters. That flows as well. So I'm just, like I say, this is on the top of my mind today. I'm just going, boy, I wish I could just make the world stop for about 4 days while I research this. But I will, and you help me out. This thing about them promising liberty is what really caught my attention, because these guys are wanting to liberate the mind of mankind. Do you remember Aldous Huxley? We did a Watchmen broadcast series called Chemical Sorcery. And it was about how drugs and things like that are part of this witchcraft movement. Aldous Huxley said, use a little LSD and it'll open up a doorway to thoughts and ideas that normally you would never perceive. That's why Jim Morrison, who I've got a quote by him in the upcoming Watchmen broadcast, Jim Morrison talked about, in fact, he named his band The Doors, specifically because of Aldous Huxley's statement. And Jim Morrison knew all about taking drugs and the doorway that it opened up. I want you to think about that. Think about a door being locked, a gate, and things that you and I cannot know until that gate or that portal or that door is open. Do you think they're trying to open a portal at CERN? Absolutely. So, and in fact, I keep going back to this. This idea of liberating the brain, opening the door. Listen to this. This is 2 Peter. I think that all of the passages in the Bible that refer to false prophets, I think they could, that's not just preachers. I think it applies to the people like on this video, or Ray Kurzweil, who are promising everybody, we're going to become gods. We're going to become immortal. Come get on the bus. Follow me. And I think if you were to go back and examine the teachings of these scientists who are leading us down the road to becoming immortals, and examine what they say and match it up to the places in the Bible, 2 Peter chapter 2, Jude, Ezekiel chapter 13, and scores of other places, Deuteronomy 13, where they're talking about the false prophets and the priests who are seeing things and are saying things that God never said. Listen to this one. 2 Peter chapter 2, talking about the false prophets and the false teachers. And it says, verse 17, these are wells without water, clouds that are carried away with the tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. For when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lust of the flesh. Think about it, people. These guys are trying to sell the idea of engineering the human brain so that you live in a constant or near constant state of ecstasy, in a mind expanded state. That's the lust of the flesh. Does it get any more powerful than that? They allure through the lust of the flesh, through much wantonness, those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. While, listen to this, verse 19, while they promise them liberty. See it? We're going to liberate your mind. We're going to liberate you. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption, for of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you know where the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is? Right here. They are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. People, and follow this. Your first birth was okay. Your second birth, when this happens, when the change happens, when the shift occurs, when the great deception happens and people's minds are forever altered, their second birth is going to be far worse than their first. That second birth for them brings the second death. A lot there. I ran with that a lot longer than I thought I would, but when I see something like that, I'm gonna study on this thing, research on it. You know me, when I get more on it, I'm gonna put it up for sale. You'll be able to buy the videos for $35 a piece, or for your free love offering of $100, you can get a double. Nah, that's not true. I don't do that. You know what it cost me to watch that YouTube video? Nothing. You know what it cost me to think every day? Nothing. My food bill is even going down. So why would I charge people to give them what God has given me? It just doesn't make sense. Let's talk Scalia, because I'm a little bit upset. Number one, let me tell you who Anthony Scalia is. One of the justices, one of nine justices on the Supreme Court. Not just one of them. I think Scalia, was he a Reagan appointee, I think? He's been on there a long time. Scalia is what I hoped John Roberts would be. When George Bush, when Rehnquist passed, when he went off the court and then died, or did he die and go, whatever, I don't know. But anyway, he's off the court. He was the Chief Justice. The President of the United States at that time has the right to appoint. In fact, that's how it works. We do not vote on Supreme Court justices. They are appointed, number one, by the checks and balances system. The president sends a candidate. The Senate either confirms or denies that potential judge. And it's the balance. The president does not have the authority to say, this person is going on the court and you can't do anything about it. Now, I'm sure there's a lot of political stuff behind the scenes, backstabbing, maneuvering, gifts, bribes, whatever. But the checks and balances system, and I'll say this, there is not a problem with the American government. The American government system, I think, is unrivaled anywhere in the world. At its purity, it is designed, number one, to give the will of the people representation in its government, in its pure form. No one part of the three-tiered, or what do I call it, the tricameral form of our government, the legislative branch, the executive branch, the judicial branch, no one of those branches has more power than the other two. If the president wants something done, he is supposed to send a bill to Congress. Congress can vote on it and pass it, send it to the president. But if the president vetoes it, it's dead unless 2/3 majority of the Senate decide to go ahead and pass it anyway, which is, it's not easy to do, and it shouldn't be easy to do. If the president, which he's going to do this, if he nominates someone to take Scalia's place and the Senate doesn't like it, the Senate can say no. So he has to get another one. That's happened. The Senate has turned down appointments and said, no, we're not going to pass this guy or this gal. It's not going to happen. So in its pure form, the government of America is good. It's those who govern that are corrupt. And we learn more of this corruption day after day after day. So let me tell you who Scalia was. Scalia was usually on our side. When I say our, I mean those who whose prefrontal cortex, the forehead of our brain, and that's why I didn't say this. Why do I keep saying the forehead of the brain? Do you figure that out? Where's the mark going? In the forehead. Is there the possibility that the mark of the beast alters the executive decision-making process of your frontal lobe of your brain? Does the mark of the beast alter your perception of morality? Does it make you drunk so that it just kind of sleeps? It's a big question. I tend to think, I think that's what's going to happen. I think a drunkenness is going to, because Babylon's going to pour the cup out. She's going to make everybody drunk. That's what I think is going to happen. Scalia was on our side. Even though he was a Roman Catholic and a devout Roman Catholic, he was on our side. When it came to moral issues, he not only voted for morality, Christian morality, Ten Commandments type morality. He was intelligent enough to voice why he believed in it, why he voted a certain way. And his was a very impressive voice on the Supreme Court. He was not the Chief Justice. He was one of nine. They all have their opinions. But in a lot of cases where a decision was made, let's say on abortion or marriage rights or gay rights or any of these moral issues that always come before the Supreme Court, a lot of times it was Scalia that either wrote, if the decision went for morality, usually it was Scalia that wrote for that part of it, wrote why we voted this way. If they lost the vote, a lot of time, not all the time, a lot of times it was Scalia that wrote very intelligently why it was to go this way. And Scalia, from what I remember, I may be wrong on this, somebody kind of double-checked the facts. When the ban on gay marriage issue ended up before the Supreme Court and Justice John Roberts, usually the deciding vote on both, what was it, the Obamacare? When Obamacare came before the Supreme Court, most of those who know the Supreme Court had it figured that John Roberts would make the final decision and actually cut down Obamacare. But for some strange reason, he voted to continue Obamacare, and then he left and ducked undercover for a while. He ended up in Italy somewhere at some retreat or something like that, where he could get away from everybody, get away from the press until it died down. Everybody expected him to vote to cut Obamacare, and he didn't. And then everybody expected him to sort of side with those who narrowly define marriage, to side with the state's rights. The state of Missouri is like many other states in the country that voted on the issue, put an amendment to our Constitution that said marriage is between a man and a woman. And that's how it's going to be recognized in the state of Missouri. Everybody was expecting John Roberts to vote for that, and he didn't. And Bush appointed him. And when he did, we were trying to figure out if Roberts was going to be for us or against us or whatever. Turns out, he's not for us, but Scalia always was. His voice was necessary to balance the Supreme Court. Necessary. And now his voice is gone. Obama is in what amounts to his lame duck year. Now, I don't know exactly where that term came from, but let me explain what it means in case you don't know. When we refer to a lame duck president, generally, It's applied to a president after the November presidential election, and the president lost the vote, and somebody else is going to take office. And so for the time between November and December and the first part of January, that president's chances of getting anything done is almost nil, because Congress really is not going to work with somebody who's on the way out. They're going to work with the guy that comes in, or the gal, or whatever. Obama's in his last year of presidency. He doesn't have, I think, the political clout with Congress to get some things done. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I misunderstand him. Maybe he's more corrupt than what I think he is, which is a high possibility. We know that Obama has already made the statement many times, if I can't work with Congress, Jack, I'll work around him. That's his arrogancy. That, to me, disqualifies him for even being honorable enough to be the chief executive of the United States of America. He does not respect the laws of the country, does not respect the Constitution. He does not respect a majority of the people in this country. He does not respect us, nor does he represent us. He shows more favor and respect to Muslim Saudi princes than he does his own countrymen. I think he hates most of America. I think he hates it. It is obvious when certain issues come up. So maybe he's more powerful than I think he is. And if you link Scalia's death with an Obama agenda, boy, it sure worked out for Scalia to die this year. It sure worked out that way, didn't it? I mean, that kind of enables Obama to do some things that he may not have been able to get away with had Scalia still been alive. It sure benefits him that Scalia's dead. Bare minimum. Here's the problem, and I've got articles here. I don't know if I'm going to get into all of them. Justice Antonin Scalia took a vacation to a ranch in southwestern Texas, just a few miles from the Mexican border, from the area called Chihuahua. That's what it's called, Chihuahua. Look it up. Chihuahua. Chihuahua. Some little dogs, Chihuahua dogs. Chai Chai Rodriguez used to have one. He was a golf player. But he's at this ranch on vacation. He had just arrived the day before, or that day. Rode around in a, and this is a hunting resort, high profile people, celebrities, they all go down there. They paid, I don't know how much money they have. They pay for, and this place is huge, like 30 some odd thousand acres. This is. He was found dead. The day before, he did a little bit of bird hunting, rode around in the little four wheeler they had and got out for a little while and so on. And then they had a dinner party that night with, you know, hobnobbers, people that probably feel very comfortable being in the same room as a chief justice or a justice of the Supreme Court. You put me in the room with Scalia and I'm just going, hi, how are you doing? I'm fine, thank you. Okay. And that's just for mere respect for the office and what this man stands for, and this is a powerful position, people. And I greatly respect his office and the things that he stood for. I wish I could tell him not to bow to idols, but that's all too late. So he has this dinner party with everybody, seems to be in a good mood, and he goes to bed. says, ladies and gentlemen, I'm tired. I'm going to rest and get up tomorrow, and we're going to go kill us some birds. So he goes to bed. The next morning at breakfast, he's not at breakfast. The guy who ran the camp, or the retreat, the ranch, said, you know, I'm going to go check on him. So he goes to Scalia's room, knocks on the door, doesn't hear anything, knocks on the door, doesn't hear anything. And finally, I mean, he's got the key, it's his ranch. He opens the door and he finds a standing justice of the Supreme Court. Someone who is in office right now of what could be said the most powerful judicial office in the entire world, the Supreme Court of the United States. And he's laying in his bed with a pillow over his head. The man goes over to him, takes his pulse. He's cold, clammy, no pulse. He's dead. Now, let me tell you, if I went to my office after today's program and I told everybody, look, I'm tired. I'm not feeling good. You know, I've had this guy harassing me online. He's made threatening phone calls, and it's just kind of got me wore out. I'm going to lay down on my couch for a while. And I shut my door, and several hours later, people's going, where's Pastor? Where's Pastor? They come in. They find me dead with a pillow over my face. They call 911. The police comes out as soon as they see that pillow. Now, I'm nobody. Festus, the police department, comes out, finds me laying there dead with a pillow over my face. Immediately, they take that yellow tape, crime scene, do not cross, and they wrap that around our whole church. They start pulling security camera feeds. They come in the office and they're dusting for fingerprints. They take photographs of the scene. Why? Because here's a dead man, and the way that he was initially found is consistent with someone who has been suffocated by a pillow. This is like playing the game of Clue 101. He was killed in his bed with a pillow at the ranch. I'm nobody. I'm nothing. And if the police knows that I died on my couch or in my bed with a pillow over my head, they're going to do a crime scene investigation, dust for fingerprints, interview people. Police are going to be everywhere. Detectives are going to look into this. Meanwhile, my body is going to be transported somewhere so that an autopsy could be performed on the cause of death to see whether it was natural causes or death by asphyxiation, suffocation. There is, and I don't know how they do it, but anybody who does forensic autopsies of the human body can tell whether or not they were suffocated. There's telltale signs. There's clues. There's evidence. Once that happens, once it happens, you know that I did not suffocate myself. I did not hold a pillow over my mouth until I died. That's a given. It's like the idea, if you see a turtle on top of a fence post, you know the turtle didn't get there by itself. That's a given. That is an axiom. It's accepted without any proof whatsoever. You know that I did not suffocate myself by smashing the pillow over my mouth. So it was not suicide if I died by asphyxia. Now, again, I'm nobody. This would not make national headlines. We're talking about a sitting member of the United States Supreme Court who was found dead in his room with a pillow over his head. Now, let me tell you what happened. All the stories that I have here, I posted them on Facebook.com/Pastor Mike Online. There it is right there. You go read them. Because there are conspiracy theories out there now. And I can't say that these people are nuts. Because let me tell you what happened. Upon discovering that the Supreme Court Justice Scalia had died in his bed with a pillow over his face, what should have happened is FBI agents should have been down there in a matter of at least an hour. Helicopters flying around the ranch. News media trying to cover the scene. Crime scene tape all over the place. Forensic detectives going through that room with everything that they've got. The body meticulously loaded into a body and evidence preserving bag, taken out on a stretcher in an official vehicle of some kind, with at least a 10-man escort taking it to a medical examiner's office where at least three or four medical examiners surrounded by FBI agents doing a medical exam on this body to determine one very simple thing. Was this asphyxiation? Did Scalia receive an injection of some drug that causes a heart attack without leaving very much of a trace evidence that it happened? Very simple in today's world to determine this. That's what should have happened. But it didn't. Some local sheriffs showed up, checked his pulse. It took them, I don't know how many hours, to find what amounted to an Obama appointee as a coroner or I have to read the stories again, some sort of law enforcement official decided that it was too much trouble to drive all the way out there to take a look at the body. So over the phone, he declared that Scalia died of natural causes. End of story. That's it right there. Once that went into place, that's it. End of the investigation. No suicide, no homicide, no political assassination, nothing. So then a funeral home is chosen. The official word to the media is the family did not want an autopsy. Fooey on that. This is one of the most important, powerful men in the United States of America. Who cares what the family wanted? Do the autopsy. Find out how he died. Because something's not right. Funeral home comes out, picks up the body. Then he gets the escort. He's got, I don't know how many police cars surrounding this funeral home car, taking it to whatever funeral home it is. Texas law says that before this body leaves the state of Texas, it has to be embalmed. That's Texas law. Now, the body, my brother-in-law is an embalmer. He does this. I've helped him pick up bodies. I've been to his office numerous times. I've watched him do embalmings. I've seen people that have had full body autopsies done. I've seen the results. And I can tell you that once, my brother-in-law, he's a good embalmer. He does a good job. And he makes a good living at this. I've seen the body come in that had had an autopsy done, and I'm just going. And I said, I've seen a lot of deer gutted. I've never seen a human. And I've seen the work that he does when he gets the body. You would never know. You would never know what they did in an autopsy to that body by the time a good embalmer gets done with it. You'd never know. Mm-mm. So why not an autopsy? Why not? It's not to preserve his body, because any good embalmer can fix that. I mean, they can't fix it permanently. He's not going to come back to life again, but they can make him look good. Why no autopsy? But here's what I was saying a while ago. They can, and my brother-in-law has this, they can take that body and put it in a cold storage place, usually the ones that they have on site, and he has one, and they can remain, I won't say indefinitely, but they can remain in there quite a long time without being embalmed. Now, there's a story here that is asking the question, will Texas governor call for investigation into Scalia death? Over the weekend, Texas Governor Greg Abbott's office sent out a somber condolence recognizing the late Associate Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia. Since the governor's statement, additional information has come to light, painting the circumstances surrounding Scalia's death as anything but ordinary. Will he order an autopsy? Here's what I... There's all kinds of possibilities here. He may initially come out making a statement that an autopsy should be done, and then a day later, after, a late-night phone call, send out a press release and say, we're not going to call for an autopsy. What does that tell you? It's kind of like the day the Alfred P. Murrah building was bombed, and every news report that day coming out and saying there are more bombs in the building, so much so that the FBI issued an immediate warning to evacuate all news media, everybody out of the area, because they discovered more bombs on the pillars of that building that had not been detonated. And then, after the all clear is given and the news media is allowed to come back, they then issued the statement saying, bomb? What bomb? There's no bomb. We didn't say that. That's stupid. We didn't say bomb. I don't know what's going to happen. But the fact that there are conspiracy theories swirling all over the internet, those theories, and you know me, I kind of go off on some of these wacko conspiracy nuts on the internet that are just waiting to make stuff up based upon nothing whatsoever about just about everything that happens. And I just don't go for that stuff. I think you ought to have facts in hand. I think you ought to have at least a pretty good idea. And some things just don't sound rational, reasonable. And so I just don't buy it. I'm iffy on, now I'm going to get emails and people are going to be mad. I'm iffy on whether there were bombs in building Tower 1 and Tower 2. Building 7? That building was brought down by detonation. There's no doubt in my mind about it. That building was brought down on purpose, not by two airplanes. The Alfred P. Murrah building, everybody's looking for mystery person number three, describing him, sketch artist, picture of him, and then all of a sudden they're going, person number three, what are you talking about? Person number three. Let me, let's see what else is. Oh. Take your Bibles. Let me cut to the Bible here. Here's one of the stories that to me, turn to 1 Timothy. One of the stories here that if you ever want to try to make sense of something, this is how it works. Let me explain it this way. I'm going to be in conference in Fargo, North Dakota, Moorhead, Minnesota. They're twin cities. March, when is it? I want everybody to come. March, let's see here. 17th, 18th, 19th, 20th. The conference begins on Friday the 18th, Saturday the 19th, Sunday the 20th. A man that I love and respect greatly, I've not talked to him in several years, Chris Pinto, is going to be there. He's got some awesome videos out. Riddles in Stone is one of them, where he looked into some of the secrets in Washington, D.C. A Lamp in the Darkness. Chris Pinto says the Vatican is a whore of Babylon, and they hate the Word of God. And he did a really good expose of that. If you've not seen it, get a copy of it from him. Now, that's his living, all right? And he sells his videos. And I encourage you, get a copy, okay? Because he is a trained filmmaker. And he's good at it, too. But he did a documentary on the Georgia Guidestones. I've watched half of it. And he does his research. He does his homework. And I'm into half of it, and I'm going, this is good. The Georgia Guidestones are a call for a reduction of the population down to, 500,000, 500 million? Something like that? Which is a huge reduction in the population of the United States. Now, there are some people who, based upon that, think that the whole plan of everything is to kill off almost everybody on the planet. I disagree. And I disagree for one biblical reason. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10 says, "For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." But you'd ask the question. There's a list online of the 50 richest human beings in the world, and all of them have net worth in excess of at least $10 billion. Mark Zuckerberg, I think he's one of the top ones, and you're talking 60, 70, 80 billion dollars that he's worth. The stock market can tank in one weekend. He'll lose $12 billion of his net worth, and he goes, "Yeah." And then a few months later, he gets it all back. The question is, these people are never, no one ever, well, I won't say no one ever, but the rich and wealthy people of the world never say to themselves, "Okay, I've made $10 billion. What do I need more for? Let's kill off everybody on the earth except about 500,000 slaves, and I'll live out my life in luxury." Now, let me tell you something. Rich people only have one goal in mind: getting richer. That is what compels them. That is what drives them. That's why they do what they do. None of those 50 richest, wealthiest billionaires in the world, none of them received an inheritance of, let's say, $25 billion and then just said, put that in my checking account. I'm going to spend as much as I can in this lifetime. I don't need to make any more money. There are people like Mark Zuckerberg, a college student with barely enough gas money, now is the wealthiest, without a doubt, the wealthiest American, the wealthiest human on the planet. And what I'm saying is, he didn't receive an inheritance. He it's self-earned. Got it by either his creativity, his work, or whatever he did. And here's what I'm saying. Even the people on the list that inherited their wealthy family's money, they took that then and used it in innovative ways to make more money. And here's what I'm saying. I don't know that everybody who is evil in the world, who has a ton of power and influence in the world, I don't think that they're all that interested in reducing the population of the world by 6.5 billion people. For one reason. 6.5 or 7 billion people, and that number is growing, are all people who will need a cell phone. And the prospect of a billionaire reducing his own potential net worth by orchestrating a series of events that will kill 6.5 billion potential new customers, it's not that appealing. Apple has an agenda, and I believe it's a New World Order agenda, but Apple's agenda is to not reduce the population of the planet. Apple wants there to be more people born on the planet, because for every child that is born on that planet, within 10 to 15 years, they're going to become customers. That's what I think is ruling right now. The love of money is the root of all evil. So lo and behold, here's an article. Where is this from? News.yahoo.com. Scalia's death boosts the legal chances for Obama's climate plan. Cue the music. Steam rises from the stakes of the coal-fired Jim Bridger power plant outside Point of the Rocks, Wyoming, in this file photo taken March 14th. A vote to block the Obama administration's ambitious climate regulation, known as the Clean Power Plan, was one of Antonin Scalia's last acts as a Supreme Court justice. His sudden death may have opened a new path to the rule's survival. A vote to block the Obama administration's climate plan. Okay, I already read that. Scalia died Saturday. 4 days earlier, he voted with the other conservative members of the High Court to put a hold on the administration's plans to implement the Clean Power Plan while it is litigated. In other words, he stopped the plan because it's in the courts right now. Scalia was anticipating that at some point it would rise up to sit on his desk. They would rule on it. We know Scalia more than likely would rule against climate change. He would rule against government intrusion on where we get our power from. He is a moral and a civil conservative. He does not vote for environmental causes too much. He does not hug trees. He does not, I would say he doesn't pray to Gaia, the earth goddess, but the Virgin Mary, that's who she is. But you get my point. Scalia more than likely would not go with Obama on this clean power plan. So it was challenged by 27 states. Without Scalia, the conservative members of the court no longer have a majority, at least in the short term. The sudden shift has given a boost to the supporters of the emissions rule. Last week, the clean power plan was basically dead, said Brian Potts, a lawyer with the Foley and Lardner law firm who represent companies on environmental regulatory issues. But with Scalia's death, everything has changed. Now, let me give you just, in the few minutes we have left, let me give you just a little bit of idea of how climate change is one of the biggest industrial scams the world has ever seen. Al Gore goes out preaching the gospel for Gaia, Mother Earth, writes a book, Earth in the Balance. At first, he's saying, we need to stop global warming. Then when it became obvious that the Earth was not warming, we need to stop global cooling. We need to stop climate change. Because you notice they don't call it global warming anymore. They call it climate change. And the whole premise is, there's a big hole in the ozone layer down in Antarctica. And that hole was caused by hairspray and fossil fuels. Well, the hole's closed. It's not there anymore. So he goes around preaching to everybody, making documentaries, making speeches where he earns probably in excess of $1 million when he stands in speaks. I'm sorry to say that I will not earn near that much at the Fargo conference. Neither will Chris Pinto. At least I don't think Chris will get that much. Then, Al Gore and others who are preaching this gospel are investing heavily in companies who will, at the very split second that the United States decides to go with a clean power plan, act, or law, or whatever it is, they know for a fact then that these particular companies are going to rake in billions of dollars because they're the companies who would provide for corporations monitoring, cleaning, consultation, whatever it is. These companies would make billions of dollars, and Al Gore has invested in them, which makes him a recipient of at least part of these billions of dollars that are going to come in. What do you think is driving Al Gore right now? The love of money. Not the love of planet Earth. He just found a cause that he could harp on, that he could make another $500 million on. Al Gore wants to be where Mark Zuckerberg is right now, and that's why he's doing what he's doing. So these officials from all these other countries meeting together, and they all come out with an agreement saying, we're going to do our best to invoke this power plan in our nations all over the world. They're just doing what corporations wanted them to do. Consortiums, funds around the world that are designed to promote this clean air, clean environment, healthy stuff. Let's get rid of fossil fuels. Let's do this. Let's do that. And it's all about the money. And here's the point I'm making. It just seems to work out well for Barack Obama, probably Hillary Clinton, Al Gore, and every one of these other bleeding heart, goddess-worshipping liberals. It just seems to work out very, very well for them that Scalia's dead. And the question that you have to... Now, let me balance the pillow over the face idea. Got just a couple of minutes. Just so that I've thought about this. I'm not just going to go wild-eyed... This was a false flag. If let's say that a trained assassin was clandestinely hired to kill Justice Scalia. Let's just say that somebody, not even related to the, maybe Al Gore sent somebody down there to kill him. Okay, somebody in who stands to make a lot of money. Let's say that this assassin, he's got to be good. You can't hire Abbott and Costello or the Three Stooges to go down and do this. You have to have somebody that is good. a trained assassin who is good at what he's doing, who has the ability to get into Scalia's room on a ranch that you know they're going to have some form of fairly high security because they cater to VIPs all the time. Who has the ability to get into Scalia's room without being detected, without leaving a fingerprint, without leaving his DNA laying all over the room, without being caught on camera. He is good enough to get into Scalia's room while he's sleeping, administer some form of drug, or put a pillow over his face until he suffocates, with the idea of making, because you don't want to go in there and just shoot the guy from across the room with a shotgun and say it was natural causes. Now, stuff like that happened to the Clintons all the time, but you just don't want to do that here. Goes in, holds a pillow over the face of a sitting Supreme Court justice, and he dies from asphyxiation. And you want it to make it look like he died of natural causes. You don't leave the pillow over his face. You don't. I don't kill people for a living that I know of. I don't kill people for a living. And I'm just going, well, if I wanted to make it look like natural causes, I wouldn't leave the pillow over his face. You see what I'm saying? Now, here's something else that we have to walk through this rationally. I can't just say, pillow over his face, I know who did it. It was Obama. Can't say that. Because I'll tell you this, there could be other legitimate reasons why there was a pillow over his head. When I wake up, especially on Saturday morning, my wife usually gets up about 7 a.m. On Saturday morning, I do not want to get up at 7 a.m. But the light is coming in through the window. You know what I'll do? I'll grab her pillow and pull it over my eyes. So it's dark now, and a lot of times that works. I go back to sleep for at least till 8. And if you were to come in, if I had had a heart attack right then and there, you would come in, see me dead with a pillow laying over my face. Why? I put it there. There could be some simple, realistic reason why he had a pillow over his head. So just the pillow over his head on his death is not evidence enough to believe that a crime was committed. Okay, you get my point. Again, if it was a trained assassin, how stupid does he have to be to leave the pillow on his head if he wants to make it look like he died of natural causes? But the mere fact that there was one clue at the scene that in every other death in the United States of America, no matter how insignificant the person was, the police would have at least said, what did he die of? But instead, an Obama appointee over the phone said, natural causes. I don't trust some people in our government. The kings of this earth and the rulers take counsel against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast their cords from us. Too many powerful people, just their stock and their portfolio just went up this weekend because a Supreme Court justice died in his sleep. Now, with everything, you think Bible. See you on Thursday.